ship graveyard at the northern tip of Australia. Since the first European seafarers navigated the Torres Strait in the early 1600s, it's had a reputation.
The water in the Torres Strait is very treacherous. A lot of the passages here are pretty narrow, and there's no room for error.
The strait is littered with wrecks. In 1970, what was then Australia's largest oil spill happened in these waters.
Everything collapsed in the region, from the pearling industry to affecting the crayfish industry to the fishing industry too as well. So it affected everything.
The tanker Oceanic Grandeur ran aground and spilled thousands of tons of crude into the pristine environment.
That's the worst nightmare. You know, we have done so much since that time to prevent that sort of risk happening, but because of the nature of that waterway, there is still risk there.
The Oceanic Grandeur showed how unprepared authorities were and led to the creation of a national oil spill plan. Eddie Hegel was there for the cleanup operation.
It seemed a very amateur, small-time effort at that time. Now, today we would do better. There is no question about that. We learned a lot.
One group did much of the work.
Well, they were manning the pumps on the boats. It was entirely Torres Strait Islanders involved in that operation, and they did a good job.
But now they feel forgotten.
There's been no level of consultation at all in our communities. We don't even know what level of resources are available to look at containerizing any spills if a spill was to happen. We're unaware of who out there is coordinating the efforts.
The Torres Strait was declared a particularly sensitive sea area by the International Maritime Organization in 2005, neighboring the Great Barrier Reef. It's the world's largest dugong habitat and supports 6 turtle species. It's home to almost 7,000 traditional owners who depend on the sea for food and their income.
The Torres Strait is what's known as a choke point. It's the only passage from the Arafura Sea through to the Coral Sea, and it's estimated every year at least 3,000 ships pass through these straits.
That number is expected to grow steadily in the next decade, with more ports on Queensland's east coast and mines on western Cape York. The Prince of Wales Channel is the only route through.
It's a pretty narrow passage, as you can see.
In places, it's only a few hundred metres wide and 13 metres deep. Oil tankers, container ships, bulk carriers, cruise liners and even submarines use the channel. Authorities are focused on accident prevention.
We have emerging technologies. We have better electronic charting and display information systems. We have the underkeel clearance system and pilotage up there.
In 2009, an oil tanker ran aground, despite a pilot being on board. No oil was spilt. The Atlantic Blue was the 16th serious grounding in the Strait since the Oceanic Grandeur. An investigation by the Australian Transport Safety Bureau found human error was at fault and uncovered significant pilotage safety issues.
Am I satisfied it's at a reasonable state now? Yes. Are there other elements we want to continue to address? Yes.
If the nightmare were to happen again, Maritime Safety Queensland has an employee and so-called first strike equipment on Thursday Island. The MV Nautilus is for harbour spills, one in the open waters of the Strait would be almost impossible to contain.
We're not going to prevent the impact from occurring. We can minimise what that impact is within the constraints of the environment itself.
Then there's Queensland's Torres Plan, part of the National Oil Spill Plan, created in response to the Oceanic Grandeur.
The Queensland Government actually takes the lead through Maritime Safety Queensland.
Maritime Safety Queensland declined repeated requests for an interview. Mario Sabatino has 26 years experience in the Queensland maritime industry.
I'm a level 4 oil spill responder. I've done my training with MSQ, and we have yet to have some sort of coordinated approach up here in the Torres Straits, from my understanding.
A Queensland government report in 2000 said Indigenous communities in the Torres Strait provide a key resource base for reporting and responding to marine pollution incidents. It's fair to say that the potential of this resource base has not been utilised by the national plan, and integration of Indigenous issues in response planning has been neglected until recently. a strong partnership needs to be developed. The current disaster plans still specify no role for the islanders. Maritime Safety Queensland in a statement said it conducts annual training exercises on Thursday Island, including for the local councils. That's news to the mayor.
I do get the feeling that the state and Commonwealth are playing Russian roulette with the lives of my people.
All the Torres Strait Islanders want is for authorities to prepare them in case there is another oceanic grandeur.